Good morning. It is Tuesday, March 12th. We are on our way to go get breakfast. We got a gift card from... I think your Grandma Mary for
Christmas.
Well, yeah, for Christmas. Would you like to tell the story?
Oh, go for it. It sounded like you were sure.
I was trying to back up and do multiple things at once.
So we. Helping you out. It's either like dead air.
Bleh. Well, that's the beauty of vlogs. I can cut out the dead air, unlike podcasts where you just kind of have dead air. Anyway. So we're going to a restaurant called First Watch. They specialize in breakfast food.
Yeah, breakfast and brunch.
Breakfast and brunch. It's really, really good. So thank you, Grandma Mary, for the gift card. We're going to go enjoy it.
Pancakes.
We're going to go enjoy pancakes.
Sawyer, pancakes.
So let's go ahead and roll the intro. We got a lot going on today. So a lot going on today. A lot of time-sensitive things. So let's get it started. What did you get to eat, buddy? What is that? Pancake?
What's this?
Amanda, what did you get to eat?
Avocado toast and scrambled eggs.
And I got the delicious French toast and bacon.
All right, so we just finished breakfast at First Watch. It was pretty good, a little on the pricey side. Freaking $20 for French toast and bacon. But it was good. Apparently they put crack in their pancakes because Sawyer wants his pancakes. So we're gonna run home, drop off the leftovers. I'm gonna grab a measuring tape and then we're gonna head to the first house in Miamisburg.
This is one we haven't seen yet.
The location was a little spotty.
Yeah, I don't know about the neighborhood.
It was a little spotty. We kind of Google mapped it and went through and kind of looked at the neighborhood and stuff like that. That's great. We'll see. You never know. So, all right, let's get to it. Thank you. All right. So, a lot's happened since...
When did we last check in?
We checked in when we were going to the first house.
We haven't even talked about each of the houses.
We have not talked about... We have, well, keep in mind, two of them we have already seen. So we went and saw five houses today.
Right.
The first one we saw, liked it, was it was on Lloyd Avenue or something like that, up or down in Springboro.
Miamisburg.
Miamisburg. And we liked it. Open floor plan, smallish basement that had the laundry room and like a computer area carpeted. One car attached garage.
Not as much storage,
but a more modern look, which I think kind of was what you enjoyed about it. Kind of had like the lofted ceiling with like the exposed beam across, which was really cool looking. They did do a nice job with it.
Which is why it's probably already pending.
Right.
Since
we got home. Yeah. So by the time we finished. Looking at our options, it went up pending. So that made our decision a little easier. So then we also went and looked at Gorman again, and we went and looked at, what was the...
Lawnwood
again. Lawnwood at the very tip top of our price range with the higher taxes because it's in Kettering, so it's a little bit more of a more desirable location in this area. Still liked it. I actually liked it going through it again this time, more so than I did the first time we went through it. The kitchen really, I mean, the kitchen, after looking in like at the appliances a little bit closer, some of them are not even usable at this point. One of which was the dishwasher, which I know you can live without a dishwasher. But
yeah, just the thought of living in a house that's sitting there in
right, which
condition is just.
But anyway, at any rate, then we went and saw two other properties. We saw one that was a foreclosure, that was in Clayton or still in Englewood.
I think that's technically Clayton. It's right there on the border.
Yeah, so it was in Clayton. The house was amazing. Like.
Could have been amazing.
It probably once was amazing. Like four bedrooms upstairs, two full baths upstairs, walk-in closet for the master bedroom. Like it was, would have been amazing. The basement was completely unfinished, which is finishable. They got like the real nice, like 6 foot concrete walls. So, yeah, no problem leaking there. I didn't see any like foundation issues. But we did notice termite damage on the outside.
Door jam.
A lot of the interiors, like, you know, kind of creak a little bit more than normal. Just kind of a little off-putting.
It was going to need some work, especially when you're not getting what you're sure getting into with termite damage.
Right.
And the fact that it is a short sale foreclosure, they're not going to do repairs.
Right. The kitchen was in more disarray than Lawnwood. They had a drop ceiling, which at first glance, I was like, oh, well, we can fix this. You know, they looked under a couple tiles and, you know, oh, this is fine. I don't know why they even did this. And then finally got to like above the sink, all the plumbing for the bathrooms upstairs is below the floor joists rather than going through the floor joists. And it's like, well, that's why there's a drop ceiling.
Right.
So unfortunately, that would have been way, you know,
a little over our heads.
Yeah. All the carpet upstairs would need to be ripped out and fixed. A bunch of the door trim on the doors has some type of claw marks from a very large dog.
Yes.
Like
really deep grooves.
It almost looks like someone took like a handsaw and was like,
it's a little weird.
Yeah, so that was a no-no.
And then we saw one on Wing.
And then we saw, that one was in Kettering.
Yes, right around the corner from the other Lawnwood one that we had mentioned.
Yeah.
And that one is an estate sale. Older person not living there anymore, the kids selling the house kind of deal. They have done some updates to, I know some painting that from the pictures had been done, which is nice. The carpet's been ripped up and exposing really nice hardwood floors on the first floor. But the kitchen bathroom's neat and gutted.
The basement.
Looks like it's straight out of the 1970s.
Right.
So, yeah, that one, unfortunately, especially, again, being at the top of the budget with the higher taxes, was just not feasible for us.
And you didn't mention original bathroom.
Oh, yeah.
From the 70s. Like, original, like, pink.
50s.
Oh, 50s, excuse me.
That would be 50s.
Pink bathroom tiles, the vertical, like, weird, what do they call them? Fluorescent bulbs, like, on by the vanity, like, the two vertical ones.
It was pretty cool. Very retro.
I think the toilet was pink, too, wasn't it?
Probably.
I'm pretty sure the toilet and the tub, there was no tub, it was a stand-up shower, and the bottom of it was just...
There was a tub in the other bathroom.
It was just eroded. So that was going to be one of those, yeah, you got to gut this entire thing.
The windows were original too, the original metal.
Yep.
They have
not been replaced. Yep, single pane metal frame
and
windows.
And a hot tub that was dropped into the deck.
Oh yeah,
hot tub
was dropped into the middle of one of the platforms on the deck, so that...
Which I've seen, that's not an uncommon thing to happen, but right. It wouldn't need to be
gone. Oh yeah. So
anyway, that house was not an option. So we were left basically with three options. The lesser expensive one in Miamisburg was funding by the time we got home. So we're
right.
Like, well, that takes care of that option.
Yeah, so we had Miamisburg, Inglewood, and Kettering. Those were the three houses that we were looking
top
at.
Contenders.
Yep, so then Miamisburg got bought out from underneath us. So then it left us with Grohmann and... Gorman. I keep saying Gorman.
You're never going to be able to, like, remember our street name.
Yeah, I never will. Spoiler alert.
I guess I gave away the ending there.
The other one. Kettering. Yeah. So.
We discussed it. You decided that you wanted the one in... You said you wanted the one in Inglewood.
Right.
Okay.
But you're the one that pulled the trigger, so...
I thought it was a mutually discussed decision.
It was a mutually discussed decision. I don't know. Just the layout, the size.
We were going into a much bigger house.
Yep.
Much bigger.
Much bigger house. The storage is there. Two car attached garage with a little bit of room for. I mean, there's already a freezer there.
Well, and there's like a large closet thingy on the side.
Right. So we're gonna drop off Sawyer at your dad's house, and we've got our Tuesdays together. Group that we're going to be going to.
Yeah,
so
I almost forgot. Well, I did forget about until I was reminded.
So we're going to go do that. All right. So spoiler alert. We ended up going with the Gorman house. Like you said, much larger space, nice office space, two full bathrooms that are in. One's a master bathroom. The other one is a usable full bath, unlike some of the houses we went through where there was a full bathroom in the basement, nowhere near anybody's living facilities, like any bedrooms or anything.
The one was hilarious because it was just a toilet in the open.
Right.
Like, there wasn't even a door or a wall. Like,
right.
It was just a toilet sitting next to the washer and dryer in this big room.
Right. And the only reason they could call it a bathroom is because it had the wash sink next to it. So, little... misleading there, but
the tile's new and fashionable and nice looking.
Oh, you mean in Gorman?
Yeah.
Yep. The kitchen's amazing.
It's got a really pretty slate backsplash.
Oh, you're talking about the
kitchen.
No, you're talking about the bathroom with the.
I was originally, yes.
Yeah, both bathrooms actually look pretty well kept up. There's really not a lot that I mean. A fresh coat of paint in a couple of the rooms, like the two kids' rooms.
And a good wash down, you know, carpet cleaning and some just general. But, you know, you're moving, things get whatever.
Yeah.
But yeah, not a lot to be done.
Yeah, a couple coats of paint in a couple different rooms. So I know the kids' rooms are pink and purple, so that'll have to go. And then the office/Four Seasons room on the outside patio, that's
I didn't mind. That's a nice bright happy blue.
That's true. We'll see.
But everything else is
turn
fairly
right.
Neutral.
Yep.
Yeah. Everything else is fairly neutral.
Yeah. So we had, I mean, it was a hard decision to make because, you know, for one thing, Kettering, the a similar location as far as, you know, driving to family and friends, and we need the same restaurants, the same grocery stores, the, you know, hardware stores, all that stuff doesn't change. Whereas this is a half hour away, while that's not very far away, still half hour away, you know.
And there's work commutes to consider and things like that too.
Right. So yeah, your work commute's going to be significantly longer. Mine increases kind of, because it's like, what, 101 Woodman is, I mean, it's still, I don't know.
It's still a distance.
Yeah, it's still a distance, but at any rate.
East Third Street.
Yeah.
But it's, I don't know.
I'm excited.
It was hard. The Miamisburg one we really liked, and for the price.
The price was
what was making that one so much more attractive, even though the neighborhood I didn't care for as much. The price was really, really throwing that into the mix. Between the other two, it came down to it was coming down to location. If you dropped them one in Inglewood and Kettering, it would have been, and with the same price and the same taxes, it would have been like, yes, this isn't this one.
Right.
But the Kettering location was making us kind of hold on to that one a little bit more. But when you look at the numbers, the taxes on the Inglewood one were about $400 a half, so $800 less a year in just taxes. And then the asking price was lower as well. And we don't have to drop money into redoing a kitchen.
Right.
So it just makes more financial sense. Yes, there's going to be more money in gas travel, but I don't, you know, in the cars, we have pretty fuel efficient cars. Now, if we were to go buy a pickup truck, that may make a difference.
Yeah.
But it is a lot more fuel efficient. If we have fuel efficient cars, it's still, even though we're paying gas, the taxes make up more than the difference.
Right.
And we're at talking 200 more square feet plus then that extra room on the back.
Right. Yeah.
So yeah. That's kind of what it came down to.
Yeah. And both garages were, I think, almost almost identical, oversized and long enough where you could put a workbench in front of the car. If there was two cars in there, you could still fit a workbench in there. Obviously, if you're doing some sawing and things like that, you probably want to pull the cars out, but you still have that option. And that's something that I was worried about with all the tools and things that we have in our current garage. Where's all that stuff going to live? Is that stuff just going to get sold or whatnot? Backyard is, I think this one's a little bit bigger than,
they were both really big.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to say because this one's more of like a U shape. What's that?
So yeah, they're both long, but this one is more, like you said, more U because you have that, that four season room kind of
right
to it.
So, neither one had a deck. But this one I can see us putting a deck off on the right side off the Four Seasons.
Right.
And then the kids' play set can go on the left side and still have plenty of room to do other things, you know, for the dogs to run and things like that.
Yeah.
The one thing I like about the second one, the one that we went with, the fence, it belongs to, will be belonging to us. It's a privacy fence all around. The only thing that we will need to do is find some type of gate on the side of the yeah, which that could, and that's one thing we forgot to ask Mary Ellen to ask about, that gate might actually be in
right.
storage, or you know, we'll have to find out. Otherwise, you know, making a gate wouldn't be that difficult.
Right. You may even be able to put a privacy fence panel in there, although you wouldn't be able to walk through it.
Right.
But do you have walk through on the other side? No. I think there's a gate on that side. So you'd need a gate.
Yeah, you'd need a gate, so.
Anyway.
Yep.
Busy weekend.
So we wrote an offer, or currently writing an offer.
You signed all the papers.
Oh, yeah.
All the things
I signed. So we put an offer in, yeah.
Now
we'll
wait.
So there's basically two hang-ups right now. One, we got inspections are Tuesday next week, so a week from today for our house. Then we'll have to do, actually it's three hangups. They have to accept our offer on this property, and then we have to get inspections done on that property. Which, from? What?
And then inspections on our property.
Right, that's what I meant. Yeah, there's so two sets of inspections and approval of our contract.
We still have a long way to go.
Still a long way to go. I'm hopeful. I'm kind of excited. A lot of changes. Still more changes to come. Some stuff that we can't talk about right now. But lots of stuff changing.
I'm not excited yet. I'm trying not to get excited yet.
I am pretty excited. I'm pretty excited.
Right now, I was really excited at one point, and I've kind of come down from that, and I'm kind of just like, this is a lot of change, and it's a little overwhelming. And
tell me about it.
Go through. I know.
Tell me about it.
And some of this may or may not work out the way we want. So I'm just kind of, I think, in this acceptance of waiting and seeing.
Just kind of let it go with the flow.
Yeah. I wasn't that way, and I've kind of come on the other side of it to that point.
Mm-hmm.
So, anyhow. It's made me exhausted.
Right.
Sawyer did a good job of hanging with us today while we went through all these houses and drove all around.
Yeah, he's a good little traveler. He
Not usually,
but today he did a really good job. I'm impressed. So, anyway, so we're on our way to our Tuesdays Together group. This is a group that meets every second Tuesday of the month. They have like a different, it's at a different location, different small business or...
We're at the Dayton Metro Library this week. Yep. I have not been to this new building, so I'm excited to see it actually.
Yeah, they just remodeled it. And it looks really cool from the outside. It's got like a giant creeper leg from Minecraft. Yeah. We should probably preface that, creeper leg. So we meet every first Tuesday or second Tuesday of the month. There's like a speaker that kind of gives a presentation, and there's usually some type of discussion that goes on afterwards. This month is about Instagram.
Pinterest.
Or Pinterest, yes, Pinterest.
Using Pinterest. Sales,
which is good because I don't use Pinterest at all. I don't know how videographers and Pinterest would work, but
and maybe there are people there who you can pick the brains of.
This is true. I've never used Pinterest at all. So like I'm coming into this as like a complete newbie. Okay. I know you've used it.
I don't use it a ton. I do have a Pinterest account for my business. I know I'm not very good at it or efficient with it. I know I look at Pinterest too for ideas for lesson planning with my preschoolers and things like that. To get ideas for crafts and just different things to do with them. So I know the basics, but I wouldn't say I'm proficient with it or using it to its best ability.
And hopefully we can learn more about it tonight. I'm excited. Did I say that? I'm excited about learning.
You're excited about a lot of things. Didn't you say on the vlog the other day that you need to stop using the word excited because you're always excited?
You actually listened to it?
Wow. I did.
Oh my God.
I did.
You are one of the four people that listen to my vlogs. I'm so excited. Let's see what I did there. I'm so energetic. Yeah.
You're pumped. You're stoked.
Totally stoked, bruh. All right, so we just finished with the Tuesdays Together group. And let me tell you, Pinterest, I am now on board with the Pinterest. The Pinterest? I am now on board with Pinterest. There's just a lot of engaging ways to kind of gain more clients. Not only is it gain more clients, but just gain more traffic. It seems like it was more about getting more traffic to your website.
Which hopefully in turn turns into a lead.
Right.
And again, it depends on what your business is. It may not be as much driven like locally, like Dayton, couples looking for Dayton photographers. But if you have like an Etsy business or a graphic designer selling something, or a you have like a website class that you sell, I mean...
Right.
Or, I mean, if you're just a traveling photographer, you know, I don't know.
Well, and then it seems, and the other thing it was, it seemed like it was helping is getting more leads. So, like, the one thing I got out of it was the landing page thing that you were talking about. Like, mm-hmm. not just telling them, you know, this is an image that I create, you know, going to my blog or whatever. This image will go to my, not about me page, contact me page. Right, not right, just my homepage.
Or like what she was doing with the MailChimp and having a subscribe email to my subscribe to my mailing list.
Right.
Type page, and you might have different newsletters, especially if this is your full time job, right? And you have it well planned out where you have blocks of the day that you're doing this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you have a particularly for me a wedding. Newsletter that goes out to people who were looking at wedding things on my blog or on my Pinterest page.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe they're looking at wedding dresses and they click it and it goes to a specific landing page about my newsletter for future brides, and I make a newsletter monthly that goes out about wedding content.
Mm-hmm.
Or then maybe I have I was doing a baby birth photography,
mm-hmm.
Nursery ideas, quotes for nursery walls, things like that, baby names, I don't know, monthly newsletter about that, you know, if you have different newsletters to reach your different audiences, or for you, you know, and I was even thinking about you with these vlogs that you post and directing more traffic to your YouTube pages using Pinterest to do so.
Right.
You know, in watching your vlogs that you post, I'm on there a couple times, but a lot of times you have, you know, you talk about.
Okay, I just went through a red light.
Yeah, I'm supposed to use this as a stop sign, guy. But you know, you had a vlog that was talking about. Not how to create time, but time management,
mm-hmm.
right? So if your vlog is about time management and how do I manage all of these things, utilizing, because Pinterest is a visual
mm-hmm.
search engine, creating some kind of inspirational quote about time and time management or something, or even an infographic about mm-hmm. how to do that, and then link it back to that video and drive traffic to your YouTube page, which then...
I'm going to test this out. I think that's a great idea. I'm going to go home. I'm going to make one of those little vertical, you know, graphic things. Find some type of, you know, time, like you just said. And I'll, you know, just track it over the next couple days.
And honestly, I don't think it takes a lot of time to set these things up. I think it takes planning, and it takes having the concept of, okay,
right.
This links to, just thinking outside the box,
well,
I think.
The other thing that I found interesting, too, is she was talking about her ratio of original pins versus repins.
Mm-hmm. 8 to 20?
Yeah, 8 to 20. So not even half of the stuff is her original content. So, and I think that's what people get overwhelmed with when you're, like, and I mean, me personally, like, the vlog, it's like, God, I got to come up with a topic to talk about today. Like, people aren't just going to watch me want to play with my kids today. Like, that's not what I want to vlog about. Like, that's what I want to vlog about, but that's not what they want to hear, you know? So, like, coming up with content every day, and it's just like, just trying to find a topic, and it's just, it's one of those things where, like, hey, like, I did a vlog post about this. Here's a hot top or a hot pin, highly pinned, you know. I don't know what to call them. Image? Are they called images?
It's called pins.
Pins? Pin to pin? I don't know.
Pin, highly repinned pin.
Yeah, or something like that.
Yeah.
But bringing in, like, not just your content, but, like, also, like, pinning things around it, so...
That are similar.
Right.
Yeah.
So she sets up... So, like, just to make sure I've got this right. So she sets up a board... And she names the board, you know, very directly. No hashtags in the name of the board.
Right.
Description can have two hashtags, and it gives you kind of an idea. The other thing that I noticed that she didn't mention was there's a call to action in her description. I don't know if anybody picked up on this, but in her one description where it was her quotes one. She showed us her quotes board. Her description was something about something, something, lovable quotes. Pick one out that best suits you.
Okay.
So she's telling the people that are visiting her board, click on one of these, and it may or may not be hers, but it's coming from her board. Therefore, it's going to probably pull, it should theoretically pull more traffic. But anyway, to me, it was just like, man, I don't have to create all this content over again. Like, all over again.
Yeah, it's really using other people's content that's getting attention and driving it to your board.
And that feels so weird.
And then they look, you know, when they're looking through your board, then they might also click on yours, which then may link them to... So that's why you have to get those huge high numbers. Like, she hit 1.2 million...
Views
yeah. in a month. So clearly all those 1.2 million views on her board may not click on her original pins. They may be just looking at the things she repinned.
Mm-hmm.
But it comes down to being a numbers game and, you know, funneling those down to, okay, you have all these people out here looking at this. Then they click on your link. Then not only are they looking at your pin, but they're clicking on the link
for that
your pin follows, and then maybe they sign up for your newsletter, or maybe then they contact you from your website, or whatever the case may be.
And
but it's playing a large numbers game and trying to bring in a vast number of people to whittle it down to the few that are actually going to contact you. Or
right.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's definitely eye opening, and it was mind blowing just to hear, like, oh yeah, I spend about 30 minutes a day.
And I got 1.3.
Right.
Million views in a month.
Right.
Doing so.
Free. Like, she, and free. Like, you when you sign up for a business pin, Pinterest account, you get 100 free pins.
That, no, you get tons of pins. You're unlimited pins.
So what was the 100?
That was a different site that helps you schedule pins. That's a whole nother, like, plugin that you can use in conjunction with Pinterest.
Okay, so I misunderstood her there. Okay.
Yes.
That was Tailwind? Is that what that was called? Okay.
That's a whole nother app plugin type thing that helps you utilize
schedules out. So you can set up, so with that one, you set up your pin, like what you want your post to look like, and it schedules them out for you based on traffic.
So I had not heard of that before. So that was a new program to me. But I know, you know, previously I was doing some like MLM. Groups the multi-level marketing companies like Mary Kay and things like that, and they come out with those little campaigns. And there was I don't remember the name of it was anymore, but someone had told me about a similar thing that will schedule your Instagram post. Like, you kind of go in and write your Instagram post and the picture, and then it'll post at a certain time. So this may be a similar.
All right, turn. Lots of stuff to look at. I got like a page full of like gibberish, but
I know. I started writing ideas for boards and
it's just so overwhelming. I guess you just kind of have to jump in and do it. Like, maybe just make one or two boards
maybe
to start
just
out.
Pick one topic or idea to follow through with, and then branch off. From
I think that's the weird thing is like how pinpoint do I want, you know, like is like audio equipment too pinpoint? Is it too fine point? Or should I go like vlogging equipment? Or should I go like videography equipment? Is that too broad?
I think you could have one of each if you wanted to.
Really? So like,
why not? And so use them as kind of, like I said, recycle your posts.
With different graphics.
Mm-hmm. You can even use the same graphics on the same.
Yeah,
on
she boards. Right. Oh, on yeah.
But yeah, it's.
It seems overwhelming at first.
I guess you need to pick what you want this to serve. Your website right now is more of just a landing page.
Yeah, it's not even a website. It's literally right. A JPEG.
So do you, you know, what do you want the function to serve? Do you want more YouTube subscribers? And do you want to funnel people to your YouTube pages? If so, then maybe set up something that would link back to what you're vlogging or what you're doing mm-hmm. on YouTube. An idea that I had too is with each of your bridal clients, you've been creating this 1-minute teaser mm-hmm. that can be published to Instagram, correct?
Yeah.
So publish those to your Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
And then create some type of board that then would post back and link to your Instagram with each of those wedding videos.
Yeah, because there's not always going to be, there's not a lot of, there is crossover between, but there's some people that don't use Instagram and just use Pinterest, and there's some people that use Pinterest that don't use Instagram, and having the broad brush to, you know, capture as many people as possible.
But honestly, most of the Google images come from Pinterest.
Mm-hmm.
So when you go to Google Images and you click a picture, usually it takes you to that picture's Pinterest board.
Right.
So, and like one of the photographers there tonight said, most of her, when you look at the breakdown of her website traffic and then website traffic generated from a social media platform, most of it was coming from Pinterest, not from Instagram, not from Facebook, but Pinterest.
Yeah.
So, again, that may be how she's utilizing those platforms.
Mm-hmm.
But it was definitely interesting to see that she was getting so much traffic through that platform that I'm not even using.
Yeah.
It could be a lot of lost.
It's definitely a lot of potential clients.
Mm-hmm. At least potential website traffic. And again, even if they're not people local to this area looking for a photographer, if they hit my website, that drives my SEO up. So making me higher on Google's search. Oh.
That guy's peeing.
Sorry about that. There was a bike laying on the side of the road with its little taillight flickering, which makes you worried that maybe somebody's laying injured, you know, next to the side of the road or something.
Nope, that guy's definitely peeing.
Yeah.
He's definitely peeing. Definitely that a dude,
was,
too.
That was pretty funny.
Yikes. Anyway. I'm sure you can't see us, so I apologize for that. But I had fun. It was these meetings are always so energetic. They like I said the last time, I think the time before that. It's like you just need that one little shot of adrenaline, and it's just like, man, I've got so much shit to do and not enough time to do it. Right. Like
they just bring a lot of ideas as far as ways to make things work.
Yeah. So. Fun discussion. All right, let's go get the kid and get home.
Put him to bed.
And do stuff.